Greetings. It's Sunday, November the 29th. It's the first Sunday in Advent. Good morning to you. I'm Dr. Mitch Van Meter, leading you in worship from the campus of the Avalay Fellowship of Presbyterians. I say a great greetings to all of you gathered in our sanctuary this morning, and a gracious greetings to those of you gathered in Truesdale Hall in worship today, and of course to you, our live stream worship audience. I pray a special God blessing for you and yours as you worship with us today. There are Advent devotional guides available at the tables in the entrance area to Truesdale Hall in our main sanctuary. If you in the live stream audience would like an Advent devotional, they're available during regular scheduled office hours. Come in the Welcome Center. They'll be in the table in the chapel. Also, coming home for Christmas cards. The ushers will be offering these for many of those who are here in the sanctuary and in Truesdale Hall. And if you in the home audience would like a coming home for Christmas card, it outlines all the upcoming holiday Avalay events. Yet they're also available in the main chapel during regular office hours. The Angel Tree Project is in full swing once again, and you are invited to be an angel to a child in this season of Christmas giving to the children of those who are incarcerated. The Angel Tree is available for everybody to pick up their assignment to care for a child this holiday season with a holiday gift. That tree is in the Welcome Center area just as you enter the Welcome Center. You can do that either on Sundays or during the office hours. Sunday, December the 6th, that's next Sunday, there will be a congregational meeting immediately following the 9:15 worship service. The congregational meeting will take place in our main sanctuary, and that will be for the election of officers, deacons, elders, and trustees for the upcoming class of 2023. And next Saturday is an important opportunity. You're invited to share in Christian service. Saturday, December the 5th, beginning at 10 a.m., the hanging of the greens to decorate our Avalay main sanctuary. And, of course, the scope and the compass of the decorations will be determined by how many will be masking up and coming out to assist with those decorations. Your opportunity, December the 5th, that's this coming Saturday at 10 a.m. There will be Christmas Eve services at 5 p.m. with a Christmas Eve concert at 4:30. You can see more about that on the Coming Home for Christmas cards when you pick that up. And also, our next communion service is Sunday, January the 3rd. Welcome to everyone who gathers to worship today. It is the first Sunday of Advent for all mainline Christians all around the world this morning. And lighting our Advent candle, kicking off our Advent season, Matt and Jessica DeWitt's family are coming forward now for our Advent candle devotional moment. Matt.
Morning. Today is the first Sunday in Advent. As we light the first Advent candle, we are reminded to prepare ourselves for the coming of the Christ child. We are reminded of hope.
Not of a wishful hope, as I hope I get what I want for Christmas, but the hope of God, the redeeming hope of a strong God who does what he says and what he promises, the hope which comes from God who sent his only Son to earth that we might be saved. We hope in the second coming. We're also hopeful in the second coming when God will send his Son to rule over all the people.
Listen for hope as it is described in God's word. This is taken from Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
Psalms 130, verse 5 says, I wait for the Lord, my soul waits in his word, I hope. During these days of Advent, may we open our hearts and minds, remember to celebrate the real meaning of Christmas. Jesus.
Let us pray together. Dear God, Father of all, help us to put our hope in you, because you alone can save us. Fill us with your hope, because we know that your promises are always kept. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Light one candle for hope, one bright candle for hope. He brings hope to everyone. He comes. Light one candle for hope, one bright candle for hope. He brings hope to everyone. He comes.
Will the congregation please stand and join us in worship, and you at home watching on live stream, join us as we celebrate the coming of our Lord and Savior as we sing, Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
Come to thee, O Israel.
carries the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Name above all names. Blessed Redeemer.
Share some Christian educational announcements with you today. Just a reminder, if you haven't already received your Advent devotional entitled Our Greatest Gift, A Wonderful Life in Christ, you can pick up your devotional in any of three locations, the Narthex, Chapel, or Gym, and you're going to begin your Advent devotional today, the first Sunday of Advent. We still need one family to volunteer to participate in Abilene's Advent wreath candlelighting on Christmas Eve. The script's provided. We just need volunteers willing to read it and light the candles on the Christmas Eve service, and that's at 5 p.m. If interested, please contact me this week. And today's the deadline to sign up to participate in our special homemade children's and youth Christmas pageant entitled Miracle in the Manger. Again, parents, you're just going to use your phone to tape the children saying their lines at home, and then you're going to send it to us to be edited. And the pageant's going to be aired on Sunday, December the 20th at our 9:15 Sunday service. So if you'd like to participate, you can contact me. And I'll send you the script today. And then we have our Avalaise November prayer calendar that's going to be sent out this week through email. We're also going to put some hard copies by the leader mailboxes, so you can pick one up there if you don't have a printer at home. But please join your Avalaise family in praying for each other, our children, our world, a safe and effective vaccine, an end to COVID. And a reminder about our adult Christian educational opportunities available. Mr. Pete Ragg is still teaching a study entitled Love One Another. It's going to be uploaded to Facebook immediately following today's service. Next quarter's lesson begins next Sunday, December the 6th. So participants, you can pick up and sign out a student book in the chapel anytime Monday through Friday from 8:30 until 2:30 p.m. We have our New Testament Bible Project led by Brian Holt that meets every Sunday at 10:30 in person or in Avalaise Truesdale Hall Gym through Zoom. We have Talk It Over, led by Jackie Swindler and Michael Coleman, that takes place through Zoom at 11 a.m. And then our Sunday night small group Bible study that takes place weekly at 6 p.m., led by Brian Holt. And this small group meets in person or through Zoom. If you'd like more information on anything I've shared, you can visit our Avalaise website at avalaise.org. There are links to sign up for the Bible studies and small group that I mentioned. You can contact me here at the church at 276-3534 extension 3. Or email me at cindylong831@gmail.com. Pray you have a blessed week.
Thank you, Cindy, for that Christian education update. The chairperson of our mission committee, Rita, is here with us this morning, introducing this morning's Minute for Mission. Rita Yarbrough.
I hope you notice my face mask that I have on Pride, and Bob will tell you more about what that means in a few minutes, but yes, I am Rita Yarbrough, chair of the Mission Share Committee, and so delighted to be here. I'm delighted that our church is opened again after 8 months and we can see one another in person. So I would just like to say for just a minute before Bob comes and presents to you that I am proud to be a part of this committee. There are 10 of us on the Share Missions Committee, and want you to know that a little over 20% of the budget, of the money that you give, goes to helping others throughout our county, our city of Newberry County, our state, nationally and internationally as well. And that's about $74,000. So it's a big opportunity for us to be able to share that money with so many people. So many entities, and there's about 31 different entities that we give money to, and Newberry Disabilities and Special Needs, of course, is one of those. And I would just like to say thank you to our committee members, and the committee members are Pete Coleman, Jeff, Karen Short, Karen Chastain, Judith Mercereau, Hunt Coffey, Elizabeth Adams, Pat Turner, and Rose Bailey, and myself. So if you see any of those members, thank them for the work that they're doing. We all get together, we make decisions, and nothing is done unless we have a majority of that committee that says it's okay to do. So I'm just thankful to be a part of that. One of the organizations that we give money to is Newberry Disabilities and Special Needs, and I'm not sure if a lot of you know a lot about it. I have been on the Ruth Pugh Foundation committee for a number of years now. I'm not even sure how long, 12, 15 years, long before Bob even came to be the director at Newberry Disabilities and Special Needs. It's a wonderful organization. I know that the Coffey family knows about it because Bo went to the workshop every day and enjoyed every minute of it, and perhaps you have family members or neighbors or friends that have shared what they have to offer in Newberry County. Bob Jones is a native of Tennessee. He has been in South Carolina since 2002, working with the South Carolina Department of Disabilities and Special Needs. He's worked both with the state and in the private sector. He's a licensed psychological examiner. And prior to coming to Newberry, he worked with the Allendale Barnwell Department of Social Services, Department of Special Needs, and he's been in Newberry since 2014. He's also an ex-officio member of the Ruth S. Pugh Foundation. Bob Jones.
Good morning. Thank you, Rita. As I look around, it's such a blessing to be in Newberry. Matt, thank you for all that you do. This city was recognized with the Silver Palmetto Award, which is a great honor. It is the community within the state that is most supportive of people with disabilities and special needs. So Matt was there at the presentation and is greatly appreciated. I'm really excited to tell you a little bit about the Newberry County Disabilities and Special Needs Board. I'm just going to call it agency or board since it's so long. It was founded by a small group of parents in 1978, and it's grown to what it is today. Partnering with it is the Ruth S. Pugh Foundation that Rita mentioned. And the Pugh Foundation is the nonprofit fundraising arm of the agency. And I'd be amiss if I didn't start out and thank each of you for a very generous donation made by the congregation to the Pugh Foundation this past June. And I can assure you that all the money that's donated through the Pugh Foundation is used to meet the best needs of folks served because of volunteers like Rita and the other members of the board of directors. The agency supports over 200 people that have intellectual disabilities and special needs throughout the county. It includes residential homes that are located both in Newberry and Prosperity, has day programs, it has preschool training for children in preparation to enter the school system, as well as vocational services, which is a big driving service within the agency. The goal of vocational services is try to promote skills within our workforce so that they can enter into the community into competitive employment. You may have seen our grasshopper yard crews out and about beautifying lawns throughout the county. We have several cleaning crews called Cleaning with Pride, and as Ms. Rita said, you will hear pride a lot and see it around our agency, and I'll explain that in a little bit. But they contract with local businesses and churches and all. And we have many business partners within the community where our folks provide specialized services specific to the needs of the various businesses. As with everyone, we're experiencing major havoc with this pandemic. But our folks are really striving and working hard, you know, to maintain a very positive spirit. Everyone has tried to make the best of it. We've had several parades of homes led by our Newberry Police Department. We've included the Good Humor Man passing out ice cream in his truck and it lifting spirits and all. Typically, we have an agency-wide Thanksgiving meal and fellowship at our agency. But this past Thursday on Thanksgiving, rather than having an agency-wide, we catered meals individually to each of our homes so our folks could experience a Thanksgiving meal and fellowship within their individual houses. I can assure you that all our folks diligently follow CDC protocols, and I am extremely pleased to announce today that we have zero positive infections within our agency for people supported today. So we feel like that is quite a blessing. Our agency operates with a mission of PRIDE, which is actually an acronym of People Realizing Individual Dreams and Expectations. This is trying to provide choices for folks that they can meet their own goals. I'm a firm believer in the adage that a picture's worth a thousand words, and as such, I'd like to share with you a PowerPoint presentation that includes pictures of events that have occurred over the past several years. And with this, I think you'll see the smiles say it all, and I hope it brings a smile to you as well.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. when you smile, be sure to smile wide. And don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big. And when you laugh, be assured to laugh out loud, cause it will carry all your cares away. And when you see, see the beauty all around and in yourself, and it will help you feel okay. And when you pray and pray for strength, to help you carry on when the troubles come your way. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. 'Cause when you dream, it might come true. But when you dream, dream big. Help you feel okay. And when you pray, pray for strength to help you carry on when the troubles come your way. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean.
Oh, thank you, Bob, for that, and God bless your work and your agency. If you missed the announcements this morning, the sheets in print of the announcements, they're available at the entrance points to both the main sanctuary and Truesdale Hall, and also on your live stream rapid communication. Each week, the weekly congregational announcements are attached. A quick celebration. I say happy birthday to Mary Ann Harold this week and to Ryan Cannon. We celebrate your birthday, a celebration with Greg and Beverly Summer, their fifth, count them five, great-great-great-grandchildren, grandchild. And we congratulate Alex and Brandy, and 9 pounds, 2 ounces, the birth of Cameron Gregory Summer. And of course, all of our sincere, heartfelt encouragement to Pierre, whose son Caleb died in a tragic car accident Wednesday night. Caleb was 22 years old. He lived in Orlando, Florida. For these and many other prayers, go to the Lord in prayer with me right now. Today, O God, this Advent prayer we offer to you is for our nation, its leaders, and for our doctors, for nurses in schools and families, for those who work in our nation's businesses and factories, for those who serve us in our nation's military, for our Christian brothers and sisters, wherever they are gathering to worship you this day, we pray your blessing upon them now. Lord, we thank you that the vaccine that will end the corona scourge is right around the corner, and we praise you that a sovereign God that you are in providing this in your good time. We pray to you, Lord. We pray to you on this Advent Sunday. We pray to you, O most holy Lord of the Advent season. We who seek your hope, that we would always be prepared. In Christ's name, I pray, amen. That the cause of Christ and the goodness of God, and that the hope the continuing ministry of Jesus Christ brings to our entire community and to all the world, hear right from our Abilene Church family. Worship now in your tithes, your gifts, and your offerings. Collection points are at the entrance areas to the main sanctuary and Truesdale Hall. And instructions are coming up on the screen now for those of you who are watching the live stream. God loves. God loves a cheerful giver. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship his holy name. Sing that with me one more time, please. Bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship his holy name.
Amen.
The word is Advent today. Adventos in the Latin. Literally, it means approach. In English, we've come to call Advent coming. It reminds us that Christ came to the manger and went to the cross on your behalf. That Christ is coming again in the words of the Apostles' Creed, in the promise of the prophets. And he is coming again as Messiah and King. It is a word of hope. He is coming. Hope received. And the hope once received calls every believer to prepare. Hoped. Promised in the prophet Isaiah. Hope recognized in the sermons of John the Baptist. Hope we read of in our scripture text today from Isaiah chapter 40, the first five verses. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling in the wilderness. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up. Every mountain shall be made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. And hundreds of years later, John the Baptist, sensing that something great in the kingdom of God was actually beginning, John the Baptist came preaching, Matthew 3, 1 through 5, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. And this is he whom the prophet has spoken of, Isaiah, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord and make straight the path for our God. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. I am convinced, heart and soul. I am convinced that in the heart and soul of every man and every woman, there is a special, reserved, sacred space inside of the heart and soul of every woman, of every man, a special, invaluable place reserved for hope. For the hope that says, not just I want to get what I want or something like that, but the hope that there's dream, that there must be something more. There must be something more than just the next challenge, the next trial, the next disaster, the next hardship. I dare to hope that there is something else. A heavenly hope. A God-sent hope to fill my empty, broken soul from above. So how shall we prepare for such everlasting hope? There are many wondrous ways to prepare ourselves. We can spend $6 million a minute on Black Friday seeking that special gift that we hope And I love gifts, and I love gift season. I love getting the right gift for the right person and just see the joy of them lighting up. I know God loves it when you celebrate His gifts. There's many ways to prepare. We can hoard toilet paper. Oh, if I just had a bale of 50 more rolls, I believe I might feel safe again. So many ways to prepare. We can have a 10-day herbal cleanse. Yeah, I get that. All those Thanksgiving casseroles. Yeah. Many ways to prepare. Oh, if we could just get one more string of lights, our holiday show would be absolutely perfect. So many ways to prepare for hope. How shall we prepare for hope? Hope that is greater than a hardship, the next trial. For me, the important insight come when I recognize you begin to prepare for hope when you make the decision to slow yourself down. God is never in a hurry, yet God is always fully prepared. We've all felt the desperate moment of last-minute preparations. I realize I've put it off way too long, and I'm desperately flinging things into a bag, packing things into a trunk, guiltily aware that I'm going to be embarrassed very soon because I know I have neglected that which is essential. Possibly it's just too obvious to prepare for hope. Slow yourself down. It should be obvious. God is never in a hurry. God is eternally eternal. We cannot hear God when we are pressuring ourselves and rushing around. Pressuring ourselves. I've realized that there is that important eternal principle to prepare for hope. We've got to slow ourselves down and connect with God. Slow yourself down. It allows you to read God's Word. Let's read a verse together. 2 Timothy 3:16. Read it with me. All Scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us recognize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us to do what is right. I'm so glad for those words. I'm so glad for those words, for that God promise. I don't have to figure out what's right and wrong. You don't have to figure out what is right and wrong. God has already revealed the standard in His living Word, in the Bible. God, the Holy Spirit, inspired the Bible. Slow yourselves down and we read. And as we read in God's time, the Holy Spirit then that inspires it all, inspires us in turn to prepare and have hope again and hope renewed. Slow down. When you slow down, it delivers yourself from the curse of human thinking. Human thinking, let's admit it, human thinking is always wondering why I am not the center of attention and why everybody isn't paying attention to me. That's human thinking. Nothing could be farther from the truth. It's a way that ordains us to disappointment and confusion. Spiritual thinking begins when we look at the Word of God, the living Scriptures of God, and we recognize that is what prepares us for hope eternal and everlasting. That the Bible is not a good luck charm to be purchased and then set on display in our homes, but rather the Bible is the living Word of God that we read over and that we pray over, and that that these actions of reading and praying are not separate actions, but rather they are two parts of the same continuous whole. A conversation, a connection, a relationship, a communion, a communication with God that prepares us for everlasting hope. Read with me Matthew 6:6 from the Message version of the Bible. Here's an instruction. Here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so you don't be tempted to role play before God. Just be there and simply and honestly as you can, the focus will shift from you to God and you will begin to sense His grace. Preparationally speaking, since the Bible and reading the Bible and prayer are two parts of the same conversation of revelation, start by allowing God to speak to you first. You see, God is God. You are not. I am not. When you start the conversation, God, I'm here. I want to know what's on your mind today. Show me. I'm reading from, and then listen for what God has to say to prepare you with today. Some people struggle with Bible reading. Oh, I just can't read all the big words or the poetry of the Bible. There are many different versions in English language, King James, New King James, NIV, NLT, and that's a New Living Translation, the EVS. Find a version of the Bible that's vocabulary, speaks to you. Find a translation that you can work with, and then read the Scriptures, and God will begin to prepare you. Read your Bible for depth and not for distance. That means read your Bible for comprehension, not like you're running a race or a competition. Slow down and let the words of Scripture's depth fill you and prepare you. The Apostle James, right in James 1:25, we'll read this together. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, will be blessed in what he does. Slow down. Meditate on the depths of God's Word that it might fill you. Not as the Eastern mystics describe meditation, an emptying of all human thoughts. Who wants to be empty? I don't understand that. But biblical meditation, a feeding on the Word, the conversation with God that allows God's Word to become life to you, to fill your thoughts. Read for depth, not for distance. To fill you with God's thoughts, to fill you with God's presence and God's purpose for your life. God's promises and protection, and to prepare you for hope and hope everlasting. I've discovered there's no better way to prepare for the day before me than to start by slowing down and spending time with God. If I start my day, I've learned this lesson. I'm rushing around, rush. By the end of the day, I'm exhausted. I'm not aware that God is there, and I've made many mistakes through the day. But if I start with God, then God sets the pace and the agenda, and I will be prepared. It's like God is my commander-in-chief, and I would be a fool to miss out on the daily briefing of what's going on around me. Read with me Psalm 119, verse 11. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Let the reading, your reading of God's word, be an exploration that fills you rather than a competition who's read the most Bible verses that will exhaust and deplete you. Read the word of God for depth rather than distance. Slow down to hear God's voice. And you simply slow down to hear God's voice so that you can, remember what God is saying to you. Let's read Isaiah 50, verse 4. He awakens me morning by morning. He awakens my ear to listen as a disciple. To listen as a disciple. Can you remember that instruction? If you can, God will start preparing you. So when you read the Bible, take time, allow God to talk to you, to prepare you. And somebody will say, oh, but I'm so busy. Did you think that? Some of you did. Oh, I'm so busy. Would you like me to relieve you of the bondage of feeling too busy? I'm going to do that. If you're not ready to be set free from being too busy, then you put your fingers in your ears, because the next thing I'm going to say will absolutely destroy being too busy for you for the rest of your life. Fingers in your ears, ready? You know what it means to be too busy? B-U-S-Y. I realize this. Being under Satan's yoke. B-U-S-Y. Being under Satan's yoke. Why would anybody want to be there? Take time, God's time. Take your eternal time to talk to God. He will prepare you for hope and greater hope to come. Have a conversation with God. God, what are you asking me in this Bible verse I've just read? How are you asking me to change or move forward? What are you saying to me to do here? Not, oh yeah, that's a good verse for somebody else, but to you personally. And don't be surprised if you start reading the Bible as a conversation with God, asking God, what do you want to say to me here? Don't be surprised if hearing God's voice changes for you from a once-in-a-lifetime experience to something that happens every day and renews your hope always. But before I tell you, go on to tell you how God speaks to you, how I've got to set up, well, some guardian. Is there any bowlers here? Does anybody bowl? Anybody bowl? Okay, we've got some bowlers here. Freddie, what's the name of those rails that they put up in the gutters so that when you just start bowling, those are they safety rails, bumper rails? What are they? Bumper rails. Okay, I knew somebody would know. I see, I don't know everything. But let's set up some bumper rails. Before I can tell you how God talks to you, how God speaks to you, got to set up some bumper rails, two bumper rails. Number one, God is incapable of lying. God is incapable of deception. God will never speak to you any word that is contradictory to what the Scriptures have already said. If you think God is telling you that the only way you can get out of this is rob a bank, or cheat a family member, or lie on a test, or fudge on a report, or reason and rationale, oh, business anymore these days can't be as transparent as we used to, so I need a little cover up. God didn't say that. God will never advise you to do something that is contradictory to the principles of Scripture already set out. And a second guide rail that you set up there so that you know how God is speaking to you is that God will always greet you with a pull forward, not a pressure push over the line. God will speak to you as a parent. He is the Heavenly Father. He will speak to you as a parent saying to a child, come on, a pull forward, a gentle pull. You can take one more step. I'm here. You can trust me. You can do it. Come to me, all you who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God always speaks in the tone of pulling you, drawing you forward. He's the good shepherd that goes out before all of his sheep, and he pulls us to come ever closer. God never pushes you into anything. God never pressures you. You've got to act now. God never pressures you with, if you don't buy it now, it won't be available later. If you don't sign here on the line, you're going to miss out on the opportunity. If you don't cheat, you'll never succeed. God never pushes you. God always calls you forward gently. God never will ever ask you to do anything contradictory to the Scriptures. And with those things said, three ways that God will speak to you if you'll engage in a hope-building conversation with God in God's time. God will speak to you through His Word, and those are the Scriptures. Read with me Hebrews 4:12. The Word of God is alive and active. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between the soul and the spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. The Bible is the primary book in human civilization. The Bible defines all other literature. No other piece of literature or publication can define what the Bible is, because the Bible comes from God and all others work in hands of man. As we say in the ordination vows of all PCUSA ordained clergy, teaching elders, deacons, trustees, elders, that the Scriptures are the unique and authoritative witness to what Jesus Christ is asking us to do in the world today. Unique and authoritative. One and only. One and superior. The Bible is the accurate measure of God's truth in a broken world today and every day. And the Bible sets up the standard. And the Bible will reveal to us who the speaker of truth is, and who the deceiver and the deception is using. Secondarily, God will speak to all people through the creation. Yes, God speaks. Read with me Romans chapter 1, 19 and 20. What can be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, His invisible attributes, His eternal power, divine nature, have been clearly seen, because they are understood though through what He has made, so people are without excuse. This is mercy. Nature is an expression of God's mercy to all living men and women. Nature itself testifies through its order and beauty and reliability, renewability, sufficiency. Nature testifies that there is a Creator, but nature cannot tell you who the Creator is. Nature is subject to the fall and the curse of Adam and Eve. Well, nature can reveal to all that there is a Creator, but not who the Creator is. For Jesus, the incarnate God, the Word of God, who became flesh and walked with us, He came that we might know who God is, what God's name is, what God expects of us, and who we are to be and to become. Nature means also that no one has any excuse. No one can plead, "I did not know that there was anything more to be prepared for." The very drama of nature lets us know that there is a God. And here is how God speaks to you personally. Scriptures, nature, and then to you personally, God speaks to those who will hear in a still, small voice as you read over those pages of Scripture. The prophet Elijah had prayed fire from heaven, great man of God. He was running now in fear from an embittered queen, Jezebel. He was hiding in a cave. The wind was blowing, the storm was raging, the lightning was cracking, the earthquake and the landslides. The noise must have been overwhelming, but in the midst of the stormy noise, in the dark corners of a hidden cave, God spoke to Elijah in a still, small voice. And Elijah could hear the hope that God was bringing to him. Even in your storm today, God is near. Even when you're hiding in the dark corners of your own cave, God is still there. Even when your soul cannot take another step, or your heart hear another hopeful thought because of the earthquakes and the avalanches all around you, God is still yet speaking to you. God is not afraid to enter into your heartbreak, your depression, your disappointment, your addictions. God will speak to you in that still small voice, and He bids us come. Come from your hopeless position. Come, and I will give you everlasting hope. So slow down. Respond to God's voice in your prayers. Read with me Psalm 5, 1 and 2. Give ear to my word, O Lord. Consider my sighing. Listen to my cry for help, my King and my God. For to you I pray. So, second way daily prepare for God's hope is to recognize there's this two-part conversation. Slow down. Listen to God speak to you in Scripture. Speak back to God. What are you telling me here? What is this story about? How can you prepare me for hope? For the ultimate objective of our preparations is not to study more about Jesus. The ultimate objection is the ultimate goal is eternal life. The ultimate objective is to spend time with Jesus Christ so that He can prepare you for more, so that He can prepare you even for heavenly hope. So I'll conclude just by challenging you to accept an Advent 15-minute daily challenge. For the next 26 days, could you spend 15 minutes a day alone with God? Somebody said, well, what would I ever do but occupy 15 minutes every day with God? So take 1 minute of 15 to relax. Relax yourself and just say, here I am, God. I'm opening your Bible. What would you like to say to me today? And then take 4 minutes to actually read that Bible verse. To read that verse and to say to God, I'm reading this story. What does this story have for me? And listen to what the verse is saying. If you don't know where to start, if you've never read a Bible chapter before, start with the Gospel of John. If you've gotten through John and you understand the Gospel stories, you're still seeking truth and wisdom, start by reading a chapter a day in the Psalms. And if you've been a Christian for decades and think you've all got it all figured out, then you're ready for the pinnacle of theological New Testament discourse, Paul's letter to the Romans. Start reading your book of Romans. Save the book of Revelation. There's a reason it's at the end of the Bible until you've mastered all the other books. Psalm 119 reads, open my eyes that I might see wonderful things in your word. So spend some time relaxing, 4 minutes reading, and then 4 minutes reflecting on the Bible story you've just read. Read with me Psalm 119, 97. Let's read it together. Oh, how I love your law. I meditated on it all day long. Ask yourself, in the Bible story I've just read, who were the original characters? What was their original situation? What was the original lesson God wanted them to learn? And how, God, does that apply to my life today? And God will start preparing you for even greater hope. Relax, read, reflect, and then record. Psalms 102 says, let it be written down for future generations that a people not yet created may praise the Lord. You need a notebook for in-depth Bible study. Write the date. Write the text you've read. Write how the text made you feel after you've read it. And maybe, why do you need to date that page? So maybe you don't get the message right then, but a couple of weeks or a couple of hours later, you'll go, aha, yeah, I get it now. Go back, write it in. That's what that Bible verse meant to me. That's what God was saying. Relax, read, reflect, record, and then request. Read with me 1 John 5:14. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to His will, He will hear us. Your Advent 15-minute challenge. I'm praying for you. Father God, we are so thankful that You didn't leave us without the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, that You did not leave us without Your Word to direct us, to give us, to show us how to live the life You want us to live. Lord, would You continue to call us, to lure us, to woo us into fellowship with You, with Your Word. Help us, Lord, to hear what You are saying to us. Help us to be a people prepared. In fact, Lord, we commit ourselves. We're going to take a step of faith and say, yes, Lord, I will slow down to read Your Word, even if it's only for a moment each day. I'll slow down so that I might read and hear from You. Lord, I'll slow down to hear Your voice. And Lord, I will slow down in this Advent season so that you can tell me what I need to be thinking about and restore my hope, and I'll respond to you in prayer. Lord, we look to you to give us the strength and the discipline to put these things into practice so that we might truly know what it is to be prepared and truly have our lives filled with everlasting and eternal hope. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. A text number is coming up on the screen. You can text me your request. Friend me on Facebook. I'm working diligently to learn how to do that. God has given you all the power. You can speak gloom and doom and disappointment and anger continually, and that's what your life will be full of. Or you can allow God's Word to become your Word, and Christ will start putting back together the pieces of your broken life again.
Take away, my heart will choose to say, well, blessed be.